to do this, all we do is add the frequencies in each country belonging to the different continents. There are 2 students from Canada, 3 from Mexico, and 10 from the U.S., so if we add them, we get 15 students from North America. And similarly, 4% are from Canada, 6% from Mexico, and 20% from the U.S. So if we add them, we get 30%. We have 12 students from China, 8 from India, 8 from Japan, and 1 from Pakistan. So if we add them, we get 29 students from Asia. 24 plus 16 plus 16 plus 2 is 58. And finally, we have 2 from England, 3 from Germany, and 1 from Sweden, making 6 from Europe. 4% plus 6% plus 2% is 12%. So now we have even more simplified data. While this is interesting and provides new information, now we can't know how many people are from individual countries just by looking at this table. Creating this table was convenient because it gave us fewer categories to look at, 3 categories in this case, but we lost information in the process, in other words, information about specific countries. When creating frequency distribution tables, there can sometimes be a trade-off between convenience and informativeness. But there's no one right way of presenting the data. It all depends on what kind of question you want to answer. In this case, if you want to know how many students are from North America, organizing it like this is best. But if you want to know how many students are from India or other specific countries, organizing it like this is best. The key is to know how you're going to organize your data based on the questions that you want to answer.